I want to welcome you all to Living Web Farms. Thanks for coming out tonight. This is a subject Rocco and I are very happy to be talking about. We've been continually amazed at the yields that our relatively new systems and new genetics are giving us. And our plan is to very quickly go through this slideshow, which is going to show you some things that we don't have happening right now. Then quickly tour through here, but spend probably the better part of the last hour at Grandview, which is where the most production is happening and we have this most in use, okay? A key piece that we have nothing to do with except for finding it, right? Finding the genetics is the genetics, okay? The two sources that we buy most of our plants from, actually Johnny's is where we buy the huge amount of greenhouse plants from, but we get a few from Fedco, and I know that Harris also sells ones that are good for greenhouses. We don't tend to buy from Harris. We really like Johnny's. We do good enough with Johnny's. We get almost all of these plants come from Johnny's, with the possible exception when we get into the beans. Maybe they don't have all the beans. I think they do though. But we also buy from Fedco. Fedco's also a great catalog. They don't focus as much on the greenhouse crops though. So Johnny's does us real well. Ones that we have been real satisfied with in the world of tomatoes, and Rocco, just chime in anytime you want to speak to about any of these in particular, okay?
Sure.
Timimaro Mucho, is that how you say it?
I say Timimaro.
Timimaro, that sounds better. Timimaro Mucho, or Mucho, I don't know. Rebelski, Monero, Mountain Fresh is a different one in that we don't trellis it, okay? It gets huge yields, and we got a call out to Marshall to not be shy and come on out and talk about that project. That's his unto himself, basically. It's a tomato that he's grown for years in the field. We tried in the greenhouse and he's getting incredible yields, way more than you'd get in the field. But it's not using the trellising system that we're really promoting. But it is a fine way to do it, especially if you have a small greenhouse and you can't tie them up very high. Any thoughts on any of those, Rocco?
Well, what's important to understand about the genetics of the in the greenhouse, and we'll get more hands-on in a moment, are given our trellising system and the demand that we're putting on the plants, just know that not every tomato out there can handle that, and that these are breeds that have been selected to be productive and to lend themselves to this system that we're going to show you in a moment. These are some great, we have had great success with these plants. The Corinto, which I know you're getting to, is a huge success.
Hence the exclamation points.
Yeah. As well as these tomato varieties as well. But again, just as far as big picture goes for this moment, understanding those genetics, just know that the system that these plants are going under, these genetics are specified for it to the best of the ability, as opposed to there are so many types of plants out there. And for example, like what you were saying, Pat, about the Mountain Fresh on those on a traditional stake and string method, they're bred for that. And we'll see that later too, and we can see some differences in that.
And they do very well in the greenhouse. I mean, they lend themselves fine to the greenhouse. One last point on tomatoes. As far as flavor goes, I'd say my favorite is Monaro. Would you agree with that?
I couldn't agree more.
Yeah. It's recently developed. It's crossed with the genetics of tomatoes like Cherokee Purple. And it looks just like a Cherokee Purple. And boy, does it disappoint if you think it's going to taste like a Cherokee Purple. But if you think I'm eating a greenhouse tomato, it's incredibly good. You know, so it's not an heirloom. You don't get this kind of yield that we're getting from heirlooms. They have a large amount of leaf for every tomato, and that means way less tomatoes. And so this is about big production. You know, I mean, we actually will show you, hopefully we'll have time, that we built another greenhouse in the field where we just grow heirlooms. You know, but that's not the kind of huge production we're getting here. So then we also do beans, and basically outside and inside, Vortex and Nor'easter. Northeaster, both are what satisfy us. Just like, they both can be very big and still tender, which we like because it's hard to keep up with harvesting. And they both are very productive. And they fit really nicely in certain places in our greenhouse where other things don't work well. And when we get the cultural practice, a key for them and for everything else in here, and we'll talk a lot more about that as we go through it, is keeping them picked. You know, you want these huge yields, you do not let things go by. You do not wait, you know, longer than you should to pick them, because if the energy starts to go towards setting seed, you suddenly lose a momentum that's very hard to regain. Not impossible, but very hard. Okay. And then I haven't missed any eggplant that we do. I mean, I think we grow the Rosa Bianca. We grow it because we like it, though. It's not nearly as productive as these, I would say, right?
The production of the Orient Charm and the Pink Tone and the Orient Express as well is incredible, with just loads and loads of eggplant once they start rolling in. And they're really pretty unstoppable. I don't recall off the top of my head, but I think last season we were getting eggplant into November.
Yeah, into November, and they still were producing really well. And by November, they were starting to slow down.
Yeah, they'll slow down a little.
But in October, they were still producing like large amounts of eggplant every time we picked them. And I searched all over, including on the internet, and didn't find it. We have pictures. These guys got, I think they were 5 feet, 5.5 feet tall. Yeah.
They were taller than our stakes.
Yeah.
They were on big bushes.
Yeah, incredible.
Too, but really, really productive. And I know you'll get to this. Some of that speaks to the fertility, but also these genetics, they just keep going. And that's another big point for the genetics in this greenhouse system. In this particular, as we've constricted it to a greenhouse system, is that they're really made to just really keep rolling. And we encourage that with some of the practices that we do with the plants themselves. Again, we'll be able to do some hands-on examples of that in a moment.
And if you were looking for your own, these, like, I don't know that anybody talks about greenhouse eggplant. We just do it, right? And maybe there's some greenhouse eggplants we don't know about, but the tip for all these is every one of these in the catalog talks about high yields, you know? So if you're looking to get really productive ones in the greenhouse, you're probably not going for the ones like Rosa Bianca that talks about great flavor, incredible, you know, appearance, but doesn't talk about high yields, and it doesn't have high yields, you know? These guys all talk about high yields. Their quality is also excellent. We're not giving up any quality, but the high yield part's pretty critical. And then we go to these new to us. We just grew them last year for the first time. And unfortunately, the picture I had, I lost on my phone. So we're just gonna have to describe it to you. But these guys got, what, about 6.5 feet, 7 feet tall last year?
The peppers for this trellising system, they did well. They did real well. Nice big plants.
Very big peppers, big blocky peppers.
Yeah, great fruit.
These are the varieties for the way we're doing it. There's two selections in Johnny's. This is for a heated greenhouse, which we actually don't have, but we do have a fancy, and we'll show it to you, movable insulation system that keeps it warm as if we were heating it. So we're able to grow these peppers and have them work. These peppers are incredibly expensive per seed. If you're buying just a few, like 10, $19 for 10. But if you think about it, if you're selling it all or buying peppers if you don't grow these, right? Then one pepper is going to be bigger than you can imagine. And the average going price for colored peppers, which is what we grow these to, is $5 a pound. One pepper is going to come in close to a pound.
Yeah, really.
So your first pepper is going to pay for your seed. You know, if you buy 50 peppers, then it's $64 for 50 seeds. And then it's starting to get a little more reasonable. The more you buy, the cheaper it gets. And indeed, you can decide, I'm buying 100 if you have the money, and just throw them in the freezer and they'll hold forever. And then you're going to be down below a dollar, I think, you know. But it really isn't that much, except for the sticker shock up front, you know, because of the yields you get. These guys are designed to go quite tall and very quickly start giving you big, blocky peppers. They're very impressive. What we haven't tried, and maybe someday we will try them in this greenhouse, is for an unheated greenhouse. There's another whole series of similar ones that are developed for that. And I can't tell you how they do. We just don't know, you know. Okay, and then, we also do grow peppers on the same kind of staking Florida weave system. Florida weave just describes how you actually lay your string so the peppers stay tall. Even if they start to lean one way, they get pulled back the other way. And we use that both for the Pepper King of the North peppers and for the Mountain Fresh tomatoes, and we also use that system for the eggplant. Okay, we don't trellis any of those. And so Pepper King of the North is actually one that we get because it does well in our often cooler nights outside. We might do better with some other genetics. We just haven't tried it. These work very well. I mean, they get, and we'll show you a picture, they can get 5 feet tall in the greenhouse and produce like crazy. So it's new to us that we're trying the fancy expensive seed just as of last year. We don't have a report on incredible yields. We got them in late. They were doing well, but this year we expect to see a lot more from them, and we'll show them to you when we get out there. And then melons. Rocco, do you have anything to say about genetics of melons? Which ones work better in the greenhouse?
No, I don't. We had some vertical space in the greenhouse that we put some melons on last year, and they were great. I think that if you're going to make a melon vertical, I can tell you to go with a smaller one, or cantaloupe and honeydew do well. I was very curious if the vine would hold the melon up in the air, and they didn't.
So, and I predicted they would.
I crossed my fingers that they would, but
I'm very confident because pumpkin vines do hold on vertical.
Yeah, pumpkin vines hold. Yeah. So I tied them all up, but they were great, and it was a great way to use that space, and they were really productive as well. But that was just a melons are really great. They're a mark of summer. I think if you want, and you're using your greenhouse space. If it's a choice you want to make, you can absolutely grow some melons in your greenhouse. I would encourage you to go vertical with them. We just had them on kind of a fencing.
And we'll show you, we put them in a place where nothing else worked very well. Yeah. And it really, the reasons that you would do melons in the greenhouse, we can't claim huge yields because we've just started using them. But there's a high demand, and often in our climate, we get such big rains when the melons start to ripen that they all taste terrible. And that's not the case if they're in a greenhouse, you control the irrigation.
You definitely have much more control.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Actually, they all had good flavor. Which
and you can come to market, you can come to market with really great flavored melons right on time or early as if they were going outside.
And get a premium. And why you might want to do that is we only have one cucurbit, whereas we have like three different solanacea. Actually, we're even trying tomatillos, which makes it a fourth solanacea. And as far as rotations, it's better to have more rotations. So melons would be, instead of doing more solanacea, we'll do cucurbits in melons too. Given the huge production of the Corinto cucumbers, there's no reason to do more than one row.
That's absolutely true.
And that's what we're going to talk about next. I mean, the example is today. I mean, on Saturday, we were all pushing extra time, and Rocco and Jeremy and I were all out there getting our heirloom tomatoes into the field where our greenhouse is going to go over them. Rocco had to go to a wedding, get a haircut. He's leaving, he's going, Pat, and then he goes, oh, never mind, I'll do it. And I'm like, what? He said, pick the cucumbers, just the big ones. And so Jeremy and I went in and just picked the big ones as fast as we could because we both wanted to be other places. It's Saturday, 95 pounds, okay, 180-foot row, Rocco came back and picked today, how many pounds?
126 today.
Same
big, plants. Productive, beautiful plants picked, 3 days before. And they've been very impressive. They've been a very impressive variety for us with impressive yields. And again, the quality of the fruit is good as well. They're a good cucumber.
And we've tried other cucumbers, and indeed, I have a favorite. And my partner Diane really loves it, Diva. And we've grown those, and we have to grow some because they're just so good. But she says, do you have any Divas? And I go, no. And she's like, why? It says, because the Corintos are so good, we forget about everything else. They're so productive, we just forget to grow the other ones, And we've tried a bunch of other ones. We did an experiment 1 year, and there were some good other greenhouse ones, and they were productive. But this was outdoing them by at least 50%, I'd say, wouldn't you?
Yeah. Noticeable walk in the greenhouse. Holy smokes, just really big difference. And the Divas are great and everything, but they were really great too. As this system gets more developed and as these plant breeders work more and more with these varieties, they'll get better and better and better and closer to improving the quality of all this stuff. And again, there's nothing wrong with it. These aren't low quality fruits and vegetables. But every year the Corinto will, I don't know about that, but it gets closer and closer to being like a Diva.
Yeah, the breeders are always working on it all the time. They'll probably rename it if they do that, you know? Yeah. But and indeed, flat out, I don't think Rocco or I would ever claim that any of those tomatoes up there are like heirlooms. They're not, you know? And you're not going to get heirloom flavor in this system. This is the system that gives you large volume, protected from disease. We also grow a whole greenhouse full of heirlooms because we want the good tasting ones. But the yields are nothing compared to these, you know? So if you want intensive production for any reason, I mean, there's also, I don't have it up there because we haven't really messed with it much, but there's one called Pisana that is a greenhouse version of Paisana, which is an heirloom paste tomato. So you may decide, I don't really want to go to market, but I want tons of tomatoes in a place that has late blight and the greenhouse is where to grow them. You might grow that one and you'll get similar production on a trellis system. You won't get the disease. So that's why we say genetics are critical. A big piece of this is genetics. Okay. That's the Mountain Fresh. And as this grows, and there are other pictures to show, we're not going to take the time right now to do it though. That stack really makes Marshall happy to see. They're all full size. And that stack just keeps going as they go up. You know, there's this big stack of tomatoes right in the center. And this was the first year he tried this experiment. He got 25 pounds per plant. Second year, he got like 28. Last year, 31 pounds per plant. This is pretty much unheard of. I mean, these are the most widely grown tomato on the East Coast by commercial growers. And they're real happy with yields in the 20s. To be in the 30s, pretty unheard of. Pretty amazing. They always look good. They're always productive. And indeed, something you should know, I'm actually hoping to hook up my entomologist friend this coming weekend and get him on board to solve the problem, but we've been playing for a long time with controlling spider mites and white flies. And we have enough control with our fertility systems that they don't usually impact us at all, but they're always there. And we don't want to use sprays to just wipe them all out. So we kind of do a dance with them, and I don't think they've ever significantly reduced production in the recent years. Do you?
No, they've never really reduced production. You might notice them a little bit as the season carries mm-hmm. on, mm-hmm. but it's never affected production.
Marshall does think, though, that was why he didn't get quite as much yield. He kind of didn't try to do anything about them. We have some easy solutions if we have to. We could simply drench the plant with neem, and then they're gone. They're not gone from the greenhouse, but they're no longer attacking that plant. And it was just late in the season, and he just had already had huge yields. He didn't deal with it, and they did kind of run those plants down. He may have hit, and this year he's thinking he's going to hit 35 pounds to the plant, you know, because he's going to stay on top of that. Go ahead and just hit the next one. Okay, so that's what the trellising system looks like. It's early in the season. Within a few weeks, the tomatoes are going to be as tall as the cucumbers there, you know, and indeed by that time we'll have lowered the cucumbers. I mean, you got any guess as to how many feet of cucumber we lowered last year?
I pulled one out, and a tomato too. I didn't measure them. I mean, our cutes were probably 25, 30 feet, and our tomatoes were about 15 feet.
Yeah, so that's all how, by lowering them, we just keep increasing the production. We also, at times, bury those, and that just depends on what we're doing. Like, we're going to look a little bit at the fact that we're now playing with grafting too. And if you graft, you can't bury because then you're burying the top, the scion, what you call scion in tree kind of production. And that's the genetics you don't want on the roots. But if you bury those tomato stems, they're going to root. So we won't be burying the ones that are grafted. But we do, when we have time anyways, bury the cucumber and the tomato and where we've lowered them. So we take these, and we'll show you later on how we do it. We drop the trellis down, and the bottom part, which isn't going to produce anymore, is laying on the ground. Okay. And then the next time we're going to lower, we come in, take those leaves off of what was laying on the ground, and bury that stem, and then we drop them again. And when you bury that stem, it roots. It's like having a whole new plant. So it just really ups the production. And that's just to show you what the production looks like in full color. And when they're starting to color up and lots of production, it's the same plants, just later in the season. Okay, let's go on. This one here, this is to me a pretty iconic picture. 2, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 full-size fruits in one cluster. This is pretty phenomenal. I actually had an extension agent and a pathologist from Extension out, and they were blown away by these. You know, that's what got me to take this picture. You know, it's just like pretty amazing production. And when we get the cultural practices, if you don't keep up the fertility systems, you can end up with problems, and we did last year. We fixed it by getting back on our compost tea root. But when you're taking this much off of a plant, when it's putting this much into its reproduction, it's not putting much into defense at all. You know, defense is really being left by the wayside. It's all about production. And we want to do that. And we have some tricks so we can get away with that, you know, and we're going to share those tricks with you. Want to go to the next one? By the way, the white stuff you see on there is called surround. It's a fine white clay that we spray, basically in this situation, just to keep the plants cool. Basically, it's also is repellent to insects. It gets into their furicles, their breathing holes, and they can't breathe, so the insects stay off. And we use it for that too. But in this situation, it's on there 90% just to keep the plants cooler in the heat of the summer. What's interesting is because these kind of, except for cactuses, most plants stop photosynthesizing over 85 degrees. This actually helps them to photosynthesize longer. Even though you would think that that stuff would block some light, because they have a longer period to photosynthesize, you actually get more production because of using this stuff. So it's a really good tool. Okay, fertility. The initial soil is critical. And both of the green, our major greenhouses, I think, have really good soil. Don't you, Rocco?
Yeah.
We kind of inherited the one for number three, the greenhouse right here. Number four, where we're going to go over at Grandview, we made that soil. We had pond muck. We lucked into some pond muck that was 8% organic matter. And we made our soil, which otherwise would have been subsoil because the greenhouse was put where a hillside had been cut away. So they'd taken feet of soil out to make level ground. And it was just sandy subsoil. I think the cation exchange capacity, which is a measure of the ability of the soil to hold base minerals like calcium, magnesium, and stuff like that, it was at like three or something. Yeah, it was the lowest I've ever seen. It was incredibly bad. But by adding in that high organic matter pond muck and then compost that we had added, it was our own homemade compost. It was pretty darn fertile compost. And then we added 5% biochar that we had inoculated with compost tea into that. And we put that into each bed. The beds are about 30 inches by 80 feet long. Is that right?
Okay,
yeah. Into each bed, we put 2/3 of a yard, which is 3 wheelbarrows of compost with biochar in. Mixing that into the soil, we got incredible fertility. When we tested it, you want to test your soil, see where it's at, see how to what to do with it. When we tested it, cation exchange capacity was 21. 21 is like 4 points below some native prairie soils, which are the most fertile soils we have in this country, with the exception of one strange place in California, which has some weird clay that's 60-something. But we're not going there. You know? You can move there. That's where your greenhouse, right? Okay. Amend it if you need to. You may be low in calcium. We were, and we actually got misled trying to use just a tissue test. We were seeing some blossom end rot, which has a lot to do with cultural practices, but also we were low in calcium. And so amend it if you need to. And then grow a cover crop. And we've got a lot of good experience with cover crops there. We do both winter cover crops, summer cover crops. We also undersow. So when the plants get to a certain height, we take away whatever mulch or fabric we're using to keep the weeds controlled and sow a cover crop. So take every chance you can to grow cover crops, because the cover crops are pumping nutrients all the time. And over the years, we've learned to use more and more diversity. We've got a bunch of great videos up about that. Ray Archuleta and David Brandt is one of our videos about that. Growing those diversities of cover crops gives you incredible yields. And then we use compost tea. And compost tea is why we were able to get around the diseases. We got fusarium from the cluster that where we showed you those 11 tomatoes, those tomatoes got fusarium last year. Fusarium is a disease that basically has to do with a lack of diversity in the soil. It's always there, but if your soil is not diverse enough or if your plants are not strong enough, then it gets the edge. If you have the right soil diversity, you can usually stay away from it. And I know there are plant pathologists that won't agree with me on that, but what I can say about that is that last year we got this. And are very good. I'm very grateful for her help. Inga Meadows, our local extension pathologist, she basically said, there's not really a way you're going to cure that without chemicals. And I said, well, I'm going to try compost tea and trichoderma, which is a specific fungus that attacks fungal diseases. And we tried it, and we just did one application, and basically we stopped it. You know, the plants that had it was slowly spreading. They never really recovered, right? They didn't really produce much, but they didn't keep getting worse.
Well, they didn't get worse, yeah. They for whatever reason, were off to a tough start. Our fertility program here is... you know, it's complex to a certain degree in the variety of what we do, but it's also fairly simple, and you've said it, but we have there isn't any one strategy for fertility on the farm or in the greenhouse. It's a variety of multi-species cover crops, using compost, compost teas, and even some soil practice, no-till. We try and just disturb the soil as little as possible. Living mulches and having a live plant root in the ground for as long as possible. It's those diversity, you know, we're kind of throwing so much stuff at it from all kinds of different angles. And I think that's really what's helping to drive our fertility on the farm.
And indeed, when we got that fusarium, because we're starting a new farm and Marsha was dividing his attentions, he hadn't done compost tea for quite a while. And I think if we'd kept the compost tea up, we never would have gotten that fusarium. As soon as he came back in with the compost tea and with that trichoderma, which by the way was kind of out of date, so I said just use the whole package. We have no idea. We should have done science. We should have done controls, not treated some of them, but we didn't. So we don't know how much the trichoderma did it, how much the compost tea did it. But we got control right away, even though our pathologist didn't think we would. That's the compost tea setup, and we've got videos that describe how we do that. And you can do a much smaller 5-gallon version. If you look at Soil Fertility Systems 1, it describes how to do it on a 5-gallon bucket version. Okay, so compost tea, multi-species cover crops. I just put the summer picture in. We do similar ones with the winter. And don't we have a whole video on that, in that greenhouse showing all those? What's that called? Do you remember?
Yeah, unusual cover crops in the Grandview Green.
You can get a good example of exactly what we do in this greenhouse. When we built this greenhouse, there was a mistake. It didn't get leveled. We had to use a bunch of machines to level the soil, really compacted it. So the first thing we did was grow cover crops in the wintertime. And we grew deep-rooted cover crops like oilseed radish, Phacelia tanacetifolium, rye, and clover, crimson clover. And those actually did solve that compaction problem and get us off to a roaring start with fertility. And then we keep it up with these kind of mixes. And this mix is Sudex, cowpeas, buckwheat, sun hemp. Those are some of the ones we have in there. Really powerful mixes. If I wanted to stay here longer, I could show you what the results were, but I think we left that out because we want to get to actual greenhouses. Okay, cultural practices, and I realize I left out disease control in here. Trellising, you've seen examples of that, right? Pruning is critical here. You cannot let these things go crazy because you're trying to run them up one string. And do you want to talk about that a little bit, Rocco?
I do. If you don't mind, I want to show.
Show. Okay, so we'll get to that when we get outside. I don't mind at all. I'd much rather do it outside.
Yeah. I'll get you all pruning, pruning as you can get.
Beneficial insect management. Two that I left off there. One is grafting, that's new. We'll show you where it's at. We've yet to see if it works, but I'm optimistic it will because other people have had success. And the other one is disease control. And that we do spray sometimes, and we'll talk about what sprays we use. We don't have to do it very much because in the greenhouse you don't get as many problems, but we do a little bit, you know. And then kind of in beneficial insect management includes sometimes buying in organisms. If we're going to control those spider mites and those white flies, it's going to be from bought-in organisms. And every year, we buy in an organism to control the bean beetle and the squash beetle. We're due to buy those probably tomorrow.
You'll see it today.
See the pest, yeah. And you'll get right now to see what the predator looks like for that. Okay, you want to go to the next one? Okay, so that's just the trellising. You can see we have to get up on a ladder to do it. And we'll have a close-up of that spool. But that spool, you can kind of just press it in. Hold on to it. If you don't hold on to it, sometimes it goes wrong and runs away from you. Press it in and lower it as far down as you want, you know? Any comments on that, Rocco? Not till we get outside probably, right?
I'll show you. Yeah, it's The trellising and pruning system that we've implemented is fairly simple. Once you get your feet wet, the hardest part is working with the plants and knowing where to prune. But once you do a couple and get comfortable and see your results half a week, 2 weeks later, and you get comfortable with that, that's easy. As far as the infrastructure, it's very important. It can only do one thing, and it either will do it or not. So it's important that your infrastructure works. But it's also very simple.
Yeah. And the one thing I didn't mention that we'll look at there is that if you're doing this system, you sure better be sure that the supports can take the weight, because there's a lot of weight when you're getting 100 pounds off of each picking. There's a bunch of young fruit on there too. There's a lot of weight that's there. So if you don't make strong supports, it's coming down, you know? Yeah. Okay.
I will say one thing, just real quick, and I just want to make sure it gets on the camera too, or whatnot, but the biggest, most important thing about this system is to do it often. I'll explain it more later, and it'll make sense later, because I waited too long, and now you get to go watch me clean up a little bit of a mess. Doing this twice a week, doing this thing every 4 days is will make you happier. It's easier on the plant. It'll make the work itself go quicker. You can certainly come and do it once every 2 weeks, but you're going to turn a 1 hour job into a 4 or 5, 6 hour
yeah.
job.
That's a bigger job.
And those things, I mean, this is, you know, it's life on the farm, and those things happen. It's life itself. But anyway, that's the biggest point I can tell you right here and now in the classroom about pruning.
Okay, and so this one here is our example of beans growing in the greenhouse. You can see it's just a wall of beans. We get huge yields from these beans in the greenhouse. We do have to worry about the bean beetle. We're going to show you how we deal with that. And we can sometimes get the kudzu beetle, which is a problem, but we basically control that with surround, kudzu bug rather, not beetle, but bug. Surround and neem basically will help us to get control of that. And we managed to keep control of it, though it certainly has given us a little bit of a run for our money sometimes. The key thing about these guys being healthy is timely harvest. And that is critical for everything we're growing in the greenhouse.
Yeah, well, yes. Keeping your production up, keeping your plants going is the pruning and it's the trellising and all that stuff. And we've said it a couple times. It is also really keeping those vegetables and fruits harvested, keeping them picked. So the plant says, well, I don't have to worry about developing that one that was ready anymore. Now I can go on and spend my energy making new fruit.
And I wish Marshall were here to talk about it, because he really taught me it with the tomatoes. We would come in and we go, blossom end rot again. He said, well, you're just not picking those when they color up. And I remember me having convinced the interns last year and stuff, color up means the least blush of pink. And you know, it is true, the quality won't be quite as good as dead ripe, but by probably less than 5%. So if you're going for the really high yields, picking these guys when they have the least blush of color, the minute there's the littlest bit of reddish, pinkish, off they come. And that allows them to not be so overburdened that they can't get enough calcium moved. If you let a bunch of them be ripe on there, especially if you're at all unreliable with your watering, boy, can we see some blossom end rot.
Yeah, absolutely. And even if they are or aren't overburdened, you're just taking them away. So the plant's thinking, well, you know, there again. Well, I got to make more. I got to keep going. That's really what we're kind of forcing our plants to do under this system. And keeping that stuff picked in a timely fashion is a big part of it.
Okay, next one. That was just to show you, I'm 6 foot tall. The bed was about 4 inches off the ground, but that's how tall. That's not the fancy genetics. That is simply Pepper King of the North. That's what happens in a greenhouse if you get it in there and have good fertility, you know. That's about a 5 foot tall plant, you know. I couldn't find the picture of the eggplant, but they're equally tall. I think almost more impressive, don't you? I mean, just huge.
The eggplants were like people or something. They were like little short, stout.
Well, I mean, last year I measured some, they were 6 foot. Yeah. You know, they hit 6 foot, and the yields are just incredible.
And come August, September, you're really digging, like, you're really looking in there for a harvest, and You'll see with one that big that you missed 2 days ago. But that's a good problem to have. They're very, very thrifty.
Okay, so bean beetles, we buy in the predator there. This is a great example of buying a control agent. Right there you're seeing a bean beetle larva that's maybe healthy, but it may be doomed actually. That's the yellow one, okay? And then that one there has been, I call it Sigourney Weavered. Basically the alien is in it. We buy this organism that comes from India through the New Jersey Department of Agriculture called Pediobius foveolatus. And you release it once you have larva. There are like 25 of these tiny wasps inside one of those parasitized. That's the same larva there, but it's brown. But it is now no longer the larva. It is now the house of 25 baby wasps. And when they're ready, they hatch out of that and they go lay their eggs in more of those larvae. You have to have the larva for it to work. And so we never get to have them all the time here. In Florida, you can have them all the time because the bean beetle overwinters there and has larvae all year long. Therefore, the predator stays there. You never have to buy them. They just become part of your ecology. But it is a perfect control for the bean beetles and the squash beetles. And you can see the damage they do. We're going to show you some in the greenhouse on the cucumbers. I mean, they're starting to impact. If we don't get that predator here, we're going to have problems. We'll get the predator, it's going to take care of it. Go ahead. Okay. And that's ladybugs, and we could talk a lot about ladybugs. They're huge in the greenhouse. That's the larva. And just know that we'll talk when we get to the greenhouse about the things we do that. Next picture is going to give us an idea of some of the things we do, I think. Yeah. Farmscaping. This is actually outside, but we do similar things inside. There's like 6 different plants there, all of which bloom at different times and give nectar and pollen, some of which even get nectar and pollen when they're not in bloom through extra floral nectaries. All of them are feeding the beneficial insects and giving us the control we need. Basically, they feed the insects that then use our pest for high protein food or for nurseries for their babies, and we get control. Okay, next. Okay, infrastructure. Trellising we've covered a lot. Movable insulation. We'll show you a picture. Basically, we've got this high-tech curtain that goes back and forth and keeps the heat in. And you don't have to have that. There's other ways I'll talk about that you can do that. But that's what we do because we can. Irrigation, I don't have any pictures of that, but we'll show you it. It's really important that you have regular irrigation, so drip is the best. And you don't do like, even though they say to do like a deep, you know, you want to do a deep irrigation and let it go dry and go deep. We don't do that in the greenhouse. We want even, because otherwise that irregularity of water can cause calcium imbalances and you get blossom end rot. So we just basically run it for about an hour a day or something.
More like two.
Two.
More like two.
2 hours a day.
And that'll fluctuate as it gets warm and cool. But the what you're saying is true. Better, for this case, we're seeing better results with a little bit of water more frequently as opposed to a lot of water more seldom.
And then that last one should have been what I already referred to, which is really good support for your trellising system. And then in between, we'll show you a picture of ventilation. You really want a lot of good air exchanges in a greenhouse. If you're gonna avoid disease and reduce insects like whitefly, which really likes stagnant air, then you wanna have excellent ventilation. And you'll see our examples of that. You know, it takes some money to do that right. But if you don't have a big budget, if you go around and go to auctions and stuff like that, you can pick these things up at lower prices. Okay, next. Okay, so that's just to show you the spool more close up of the as far as the infrastructure goes. And then right above it is that movable curtain, and we'll see some other pictures of that. And that's the movable curtain there. And we actually have a fancy computer. We can set it, and it opens and closes. This time of year, we don't use it. But as we get into October, that thing's going to close every night and hold the heat in. And that's as if we had heat. We really get, it's a high-tech greenhouse. It holds a lot of heat. And I mean, actually, even all through the winter, we have solanacea plants germinating and growing several inches before we get a deep freeze and they die. I mean, even though it freezes most nights in the winter around here, it doesn't freeze most nights in that greenhouse at all. Okay? And that's the ventilation fans. I mean, that's the way we do it. You know, and you'll see in that greenhouse, one gang is pointing one way. The next bay, they're all pointing the other way. The next bay, they're pointing the other way. So you get this, like, circulation, and that's pretty critical. I think that's probably the end of the slideshow, and let's go outside.
Let's go.
Unless there's any questions so far. Any questions? Let's go outside. We're not going to spend as much time here. This greenhouse has been productive for us for a long time. I remember the first time that I was here, Rocco said, Pat, there's something special about this soil, and it is very good soil. And we get really good production in here. We'll walk along and show you it. We'll get the peppers probably up to here, maybe even to there on the stake, about 3.5 feet or something. The beans always do very well for us in here. We get good production in here, but nothing like we get at the other greenhouse for two reasons, okay? One is the longer season we can get because of our ability to control the infrastructure. We can get them in earlier. Temperature because of that movable curtain. And the other is that the soil is even better there. This soil is very good, but because we got the kind of manufactured soil at the other place, it's even better.
Well, we got to be witch doctors and make our own soil.
Yeah.
And start off like that.
Yeah.
The soil in here is great. And you see, you always see good results with these practices, but not always incredibly quickly. You know, a lot of this stuff takes a little bit of time.
If you're having to build your soil without being lucky enough to get 20 dump truck loads of pond muck, you know, yeah, then you have to just add compost and stuff to get there and do cover crops. And you will get there, but it's not going to be like we went from 0 to 60 in that greenhouse, you know, because we had these different things. But the biochar added to compost and the abundant compost in a row, you can do that, you know, and that will make a big difference. So let's just look at these, and I'll walk down and we'll show you the grafted plants here and the grafted plants at the next place. And they're just, do we have promise or not? We'll see, you know. These are trellis tomatoes. You can see the system. Rocco, I guess you're going to wait to the other greenhouse to talk about the trellising system, though, right?
Yeah, I'd like to, if you don't mind.
You can see here how productive these are, though. I mean, this is a lot of tomatoes on a vine, you know. It's not the same as at the other greenhouse where it could be sometimes 10, but it's still awfully good production.
This is a really good, it's cool that you pointed to this one. This is what you really, I mean, basically you can walk beside this and this is what you want to see. Fruit that needs to be harvested, some great clusters, and variation. Obviously these were sooner than these. And then this plant has flowers on it. So this thing's doing every stage of fruiting right here and now.
And each
so if we can keep it here doing this, keep it at that stage of, there's your production, there's your plant doing what it needs to do, then you'll be walking in high cotton.
And these are what we say trained to a single leader. If we had let them, they would have all made suckers and trying to branch out everywhere. And because we're trying to keep it on one string and keep airflow, single leader, every sucker comes out. Okay, all right. So you can see, and there, that's a pretty good example of a big cluster. There's like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 on there. They're not all full size though. Some of them aren't going to be quite as big, but they'll get there. I mean, they actually do get better and better. That one there too is a really good cluster, you know. That's 8 there, you know. These guys are good and productive, boy. There's no complaint about them. You can see the peppers are coming along great. This is the pepper king of the north. And then we get right here, and these tomatoes have all been grafted. And you can immediately see a difference in the size of the leaves and the size of the stem. They're much bigger. So far, and it has to do with the type of genetics that are in this rootstock. This rootstock is called Maxifort, and it's about making lots of vegetation. And so the plan on this plant is very big plant. You get huge yield because of how big the plant is. So it is not making as much fruit actually so far as those back there. You know, it's also a little younger, by the way. They're traumatized. You cut the top off and put another top on it. That sets the plant back for a while, you know. But they will eventually, by what I've read, catch up. This is our first year really doing them. We'll see. But they should actually, in the end, outproduce the other ones, you know. And you can just see the size of them. So this is another cultural practice that we're just starting, and we're optimistic about. Now, indeed, I sent ones to Florida that had a different kind of genetics. That's called generative, and the energy goes right to making as much fruit as possible, not trying to make really big plants. And that's because eventually it gets so hot in Florida that they can't produce. We can go all year here. This is like essentially, if we hadn't had problems with our germination, these tomatoes would have gone in early April and would stay in until mid-October. You know, down in Florida, sometime in July, the heat's going to take out production. You know, it's not even worth trying to keep them going. You just put new ones in early August to mature through the late. You know, there they can be producing and probably still producing tomatoes in December, right? Yeah, so that's a different kind of genetics. You know, you wouldn't necessarily go with the maxi for it. But we'll try that too because it's supposed to be more heat resistant. Let's look at the cucumbers here and then we'll head out. For some reason, we've had the last 5 years or so, we've had a major cucumber beetle problem here. And I'm frankly befuddled. I've yet to figure that out. We basically had solved cucumber beetles for years and years. I'm not really sure why, but it's put a lot of pressure on these plants, you know? So, and this is an example. This plant here has gotten a wilt because of cucumber beetle pressure. The cucumber beetle brings in a bacterial wilt, and that plant's just taken out by it, you know? We've by and large got a grip on it now using Surround, which I said we use mostly to keep the plants cool, but also it keeps the cucumber beetles from feeding on them, and using Neem, which keeps them off too. And this is going to give us a lot of cucumbers, but it won't rival the yields that we get at the other greenhouse. And that's okay. It's still productive. You'd be real happy with these yields. These are intensive yields still, but we can show you the goals that you can go for if they're even greater, you know? Okay, I don't think there's a lot more to show here. I think we'll just head over to Grandview.
No, it looks like they're taking off. See this one right here? This one right here was a sucker. It's off there.
Yep, that one was taken off. This is your top. This is a sucker on a sucker right here. And this is a growing tip. The grafts can get, okay, so that's interesting.
Yeah.
So here's the difference in a plant that isn't trained to have that intense trellis, and that intense pruning.
Right.
Okay, so I got a growing point here, which is coming out of the middle of nowhere. And I got one coming here, kind of coming out of the middle of nowhere.
So they react different when they're
right.
They're
so just look
versus.
At this. So I got three different tops here. Now let's go right here. Boom. One big stalk. Everything's nice and pruned. This is a little sucker right here. This is a sucker here. But
so you're going to get more production out of that one because you have multiple heads?
Not necessarily. Because of this kind of trellising system. We want to push these plants to keep going up and to keep growing and to keep going. So what I'm saying is that a plant that isn't designed to handle that kind of system is going to want to branch out a little bit more. This plant is more apt to this kind of system. There's nothing wrong with it, but you're going to have to trellis those grafts more than you'll have to trellis these.
Interesting.
Which is something you can do. It's just, I don't know. These are better equipped to handle this situation.
So the last thing I wanted to say about peppers, because I think they're bigger here than at the other greenhouse, is I learned this from Alex and Betsy Hitt, who are some of the better growers in the state. Basically, a good practice is to harvest the first two big ones in the center, green, and then let them all go to color after that. Those first two, if you wait for them to go to color, it really slows down the rest. If you take them off, then you tend to get more even, rapid harvesting. So you wouldn't take them yet. These are so dark green, they'd probably be bitter, but when they start to get the right color of a green pepper, you take those first two off green. And then after that, you get much more rapid production and more even production of the colored peppers, which tends to be what we're growing them for. You know, we tend not to pick a lot of green peppers. So that was the only other piece I wanted to put in there. Now let's head to Grandview. Okay, so this is our Grandview greenhouse. We're very creative with the names. Over there, it's 1, 2, and 3. This is 4, you know. And this is an example of the, you can see there's a difference in vigor here compared to the ones we looked at over there, you know. They went in about the same time, but these are just more vigorous. These might have actually gone in a little later, I think. Didn't these go in a little later than the ones at Grandview?
We're at Grandview. I don't know.
I think they did, actually. I think not by much, but by a half week or something like that, you know? But just way productive. You can see how we're hitting those kind of numbers. Look at all the cucumbers on there, more forming. The fact they took off the big ones means that these are going to start to jump, you know? It'd be a matter of days before they'll be looking like this, and then a few days more, and they'll be getting close to too big, you know? Rocco, you want to talk about the trellising starting here, or do you want to go up there and talk about it? Or?
Let's go down here, guys.
Okay. As we go, notice we have some fun plants in here. These are Roselle. We're not doing those for production. They're just because we love them. They make the ingredient that makes makes red zinger tea. It also makes a really amazing cranberry substitute. But then these are the peppers. These are more of the Pepper King of the North. We'll get to the other ones. You can see they're a little behind. They went in a little later. That's an experiment we're going to do with tomatillos. We're going to try them on trellises too. If you've ever grown tomatillos, you know they can really sprawl. We're going to see if we can contain them. Before you get to that, let me talk briefly about the disease, the damage we show here, okay? This is the squash beetle damage, okay? There, and there's one of the larvae. Okay, so that's what we're going to control when we buy Pediobius. Those little wasps, we're going to come control those. If we didn't do that, last year our production stopped on these because what happened was a weird year last year. These guys didn't show up early. The deep cold knocked them way back. So we bought predators about this time of year, but they ran out of babies to lay their eggs in. And then they came back in. The pest came back in from other places late in the season. And basically I missed it. It's my fault. You know, I didn't order more predators. And so sometime in late September, they got so bad they killed production, right? I mean, these plants just stopped, you know. We got 2,166 pounds of cucumbers up until not even late, basically mid-September. Had we gotten to that last 6 weeks, I think we've been pushing 3,000 pounds. But we just lost production because we didn't control these. This year, that's not going to happen. You can see they can really put a hurt on. So it's none too soon that we order that predator. In fact, we're a little bit behind. But we'll get a good control real quick. And the glory of this is, even though this looks bad, we're going to drop this. We can bury it. There'll be a whole new plant in no time.
A whole new plant in no time, it'll grow right out of it. And at this point, you're not going to really stop these cucumbers once we get the control for this. It's important to note as well, and you spoke about it too, but this right here is more or less, and you would be able to say that with more confidence, the only thing that we really have to look out for. We don't do a lot of spraying, we don't do a lot of insecticides, we don't do a lot of worrying about predatory insects or harmful insects that attack our plants. And that's mainly because we're relying on the biodiversity supplied by farmscaping and achieving that natural balance. Meaning that, oh yeah, there's tons of stuff that eat the plants, but there's even more stuff that eats the stuff that eats the plants. So there's only a couple crops and a couple bugs that come with them that we have to, that we have an actual infestation and we need some help. And there again, we're going biological and getting more predatory insects. I mean, off the top of my head, it's this and
this guy can be a problem. It's not for us though, squash bug.
A squash bug.
Yeah, like I just went.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. It's not a problem here because the plants are so healthy. It's as simple as that. These guys can build up and be a terrible problem. They're more of a problem at the other greenhouse. We don't have quite as much vigor. The fertility is not quite as good, you know. But it's good enough that we get plenty of production. Okay, so talk about pruning.
Look at your arm. This is the main stalk of your plant. This is the main trunk of your tree. Be like this. Your thumb is the branch. Your thumb's out getting a bunch of sunlight. Your thumb is the branch. Uh-oh, what's this guy? See this? That's a sucker. Okay. Now you can prune anything.
Pretty much.
We are making these plants go. We are not letting these plants stop. We're making the plants produce more and more food. These plants are developed to be able to do that. We're doing that because we're in a greenhouse and this is sacred, expensive space. If you're selling it for top dollar at market to pay your bills, if you're donating it, if you're canning it, if you're giving it away, whatever. That's our goal in here. That's what we're doing with this trellis method. This is what we're looking at. So this is a plant that we've pruned. Again, in fact, this might be the
Monero.
It's got kind of a Cherokee purple looking fruit. Again, in order to keep this plant doing less of this and more of this. I want this because these are my fruit. We're going to pick these. The only reason I left these on is because of that, and it makes a pretty picture for today's class. And not the only reason, but I mean, it's cool. It's always nice to see.
Yeah, it's the major reason.
That's the major reason. And again, if you're growing heirlooms and if you want more flavor, it's kind of the opposite. You leave the plant to develop, you leave the fruit to develop on the plant for as long as possible because the plant is giving that fruit its energy to build flavor.
And you tend not to try and prune the leaves off. They need those leaves for that flavor, you know? These guys are designed to be kept at this kind of single liter, heavily pruned. And we should see if there's one ripe enough to taste, but we're still happy with the flavor for the Monaro. It's not heirloom flavor, but it's way better than the average greenhouse flavor.
So here's one that fell over, right? This is what we were talking about, our infrastructure. I'll show you one of these in a second. This is our trellis. You need to be able to, Pat's absolutely right. You need to be able to put on the gloves and start over there and climb all the way there, back and forth, and do pull-ups on it. It gets a lot of weight. These plants will get up here. They'll get big and bustling and heavy. So if you do this method, just make sure you've got a good trellis, a good main support. It's my little clip. This is what we've been using. Here, you guys can look at that. I'll give you one too. So the little teeth in there that you're seeing, they grab that string and it clips down in there on it. And then now that clip isn't going to go anywhere on the string itself. So this plant needs some attention because Rocco hasn't been giving it to him. Poor little plant.
Right there in the hinge is where the teeth are.
So if I put this clip up here with that big hole, if I put it up here and that support comes on it, it's just going to fall out. So I go two or three branches down. So there's that. So that's what we're doing down this line. So here's a pretty good example. Here's a nice big main branch. Here's my nice big stalk. Here's a sucker, okay? This guy is, there again, the more often you do this, the smaller these are, and the less shock it has on the plant when you pick them. So I'm just gonna do this. This is how I personally do it when they're at this size. You can also come in with a pair of scissors, clippers like that, and do that.
However, if you have any thought that you have any disease in your plants, you do not want to cut them unless you're sterilizing after every cut, because you can spread the disease by doing that.
Absolutely, you know? Your biosecurity.
Yeah, is. Yeah. So it's better for us to snap them, you know.
These would make great suckers if I stuck them in some water or some soil and kept them wet and in the shade, and they would root. So these would make great suckers. In this case, I don't really want them.
We have plenty of plants. We're not going to grow any more plants. But if somebody needed plants, they could get a plant in about 10 days from that plant.
So there again. So that one's all set. And then here's a sucker. Right? And then right here is a little sucker. See this guy? Okay. Taking him off. I would encourage you to not get too hung up on the top. Let the top of the plant develop. You don't have to go in here surgically. Like right here is a sucker. Let me show you something. See these leaves? See these two little leaves? That is a sucker, but that's not worth worrying about. It's way too small. And you can confuse yourself and come and literally pinch off the top of the plant, which isn't the end of the world either, but it's something you definitely want to avoid. It's certainly not worth doing that to get rid of something that is half an inch tall.
If you take off that top leader, you're going to have to wait for a sucker to develop a new leader. It's going to slow down your production.
Yeah, and I can, you know, show you some of those.
Because what happens, we do it, you know. But it's only because we're trying to mess with something smaller than we need to.
As they're working out these genetics, you see this growing tip. You see how this looks different than the rest of the plant. And the more and more you do this, your eyes will be able to catch it. But you see this guy here? He's not really a sucker. He's coming off of this branch that's growing, just kind of wanting to grow up and be somebody. So you can take that guy out too. Another strategy, and I want to walk around just real quick and I'll show you a couple, is say I'm like, well, there's some fruit here and maybe these leaves are going to help photosynthesize to feed this fruit. I don't want this to keep growing because I only want one point, because if I can control my one point, I can control my plant. But I also don't really want to take away from these guys.
And here, by the way, Rocco's a perfect example.
Yeah, okay. There's...
That was a really big sucker. To take that whole thing off would have been asking a lot from the plant. So instead, he just stopped it.
Yeah, you know, that's a great example.
Cutting the growing tip off, boom, you know. And then here's an example of one that we're going to have to do that with. You know, now that's the main one. I saw one in here, though, I think. Maybe I didn't. Maybe I was seeing that. But sometimes they get that big like this is, and then you just don't want to take the whole plant off. I mean, the whole sucker off. It's just asking too much of the plant. So you just stop it. Once you take the growing tip off, it's not going to do anymore. But you still have it photosynthesizing there, and it probably is going to make some fruit, too. You know, so I'd say that the suckers you took are about as big as I would take the whole sucker. Once they get bigger than that, you just come in and tip out the growing tip, and you don't have to worry about it anymore. You know.
And so there again, what you end up with is plants with fruit that are ready or soon to be ready, fruit that's developing, and flowers. And again, what we're really doing is by taking those suckers and by training them up this trellis, and I'll show you with the cucumbers again, and by picking fruit early again, we're not giving the plants a chance to like hang out and like, oh, I want to grow, and oh, nope,
I
sorry.
I want to make seed, right, yeah, I don't get to do it.
Yeah. I want to really, nope, sorry, keep going. Can I just please, I got a little, nope, keep going. We're pushing them, you know, you're getting my point.
It's very expensive space, you know, you can allow plants more room to like, you know, ripen their fruit more and stuff if you're outside. But if you're in here, the space is very expensive. You want maximum production, you know.
Let's take a quick stroll. I want to show you all a couple quick things. This is where I did what I just told you not to do, okay? This is where Rocco came along and got in a hurry or whatever and pinched off the top of the plant, okay? Not the end of the world. The plant didn't really enjoy it, but that's okay. See this sucker? This sucker is my new tip, right? So I just put a little marker here just to show you. So now I'm going to let this grow and attach it on this string, and this plant's going to keep going. Here's another thing I wanted to show you. Sometimes this will happen, and I'm going to tell you what I do, and then I'm going to ask my director what he does, because I haven't yet. This is a straight up split. Like, there's your split right there. Crack right down the middle, and this is a straight up split. When this happens personally, I just pick one. I just pick one. In this case, because of these flowers, you know, and this has flowers here, and these have some flowers that are coming here. But even just given the fact that these are more developed than these are, I would do this.
That's what I'd do too. Yep.
And pinch that tip.
I mean, actually, if you look at it, to me, that looks like a slightly thicker stem, you know, more flowers on it, and just a little better leader.
Yeah, it's thicker and there's more structure. So now to tell myself that I did that, or not tell myself, but now we've kind of made that decision and that's our new leader.
So yeah, the plant's going to try different things and it'll confuse you. You've got to learn to just make decisions. You know, it doesn't really matter if you decide the other one, the difference would be maybe 5%, 10%, something like that. You know, not a big difference.
These are the grafts in here. Disease-resistant rootstock, and then a more productive, flavorful plant put on top of that rootstock. So the big reason we have these on landscape fabric is because when these tomatoes, like the cucumbers did, but when these tomatoes get to the top, which I'm going to guess right here and now is probably another 3 weeks, we're going to unwind the reel, we're going to drop the plant, and we're going to scoot the whole thing over. And we're going to lay say we drop 2 feet, we'll lay 2 feet worth of the plant on the ground. It will re-root. And that is another big component of keeping it going, because it's getting new rootstock. It's growing more roots. So between it re-rooting and us trellising and picking so aggressively, we're never giving them a reason to slow down. And we're keeping up our production. The reason we're not going to do it with the grass is because we want this plant to be that rootstock that was grafted onto, that disease-resistant rootstock. We don't really want this new. You got a rootstock that's disease-resistant, and you got a plant, and you stick them on each other, right? So I got a root from here and a plant from here. I don't want the plant from here to root. I want these roots, because these roots are what giving me the resistance for the rest of the plant.
And theoretically, also more production. And bigger plant, bigger. Everything about these plants gets bigger because they have that grafted rootstock, you know? And as you get more yield, you'll see thicker stems, more leaf mass, you know? And here it's starting to get more into the fruit production. The fruit production is going to get more even, which is what they predicted, you know? So it should be, they should be way more productive by September. And we'll let you know. We don't know yet, but we'll let you know.
Yeah, and we're ending up with some nice, like I see a couple back there and even further back. But we're ending up with some really nice, big branches with really nice leaves, nice photosynthesis. And it's all putting that energy in the center, and it's all going up.
And these are also the maxi for it, the one that's putting its energy first into making a big plant, and then fruit production comes. But already fruit production is starting to look like it's going to be comparable to the other ones. And so as the plant gets bigger and bigger, it should probably outstrip the other ones. That's the theory. We'll see.
Let's glance at the cucumber. I believe very much that one of the reasons these cucumbers have been so productive is because of this pruning system, which is pretty rigorous, and it's pretty tough with the cucumber. These are definitely vining plants, and we're doing the same thing with them. We're not really letting them branch out. We're keeping them as one single leader. So again, as Pat said, I picked 130 pounds of fruit off these today, which is good, which is a good yield. And especially considering a couple days before you got 95 pounds off of it. And we don't expect that to stop, and we don't expect that to slow down.
Till fall, I mean, once the days get shorter, it will start slowing down.
Yeah.
But it'll still be darn good production for that time of year.
Yeah, that's,
you know?
That's what
you need sunlight. Sunlight's what makes the plants produce, you know? At this kind of peak sunlight, we get peak production.
Just to give you an idea, so this plant here, I don't even know. Anyway, this plant was planted like right here. So it gets up, and we move it over, we drop it down, and then tomorrow I'm going to bury these branches, the stalk that we put on the ground.
See, I actually think, Rocco, you should wait, not take the leaves off until next time you lower, and then bury this.
I already took these leaves off. And I wanted to bury these because I kind of like doing that on their first run, on their first trimming. Okay. I like to just get them off to a good start. That first initial, I'm not going to call it shock, but plus I was a little late doing it too.
So, but the reason why I proposed that was last year, I noticed with the Monero tomato that they were really good tasting, and then all of a sudden they weren't good tasting. It was right after we'd lower them. And before we lowered them, we took all the leaves off so the leaves weren't laying on the ground, which is real important outside because they can get wet and disease can spread. But we just took like, you know, 2 feet, 3 feet of leaves off of this plant. And that much leaf mass coming off of that plant meant that the flavor just wasn't as good. And so what I came up with is lower them, let the leaves sit there till the next time you're going to lower them, then take those leaves off. Okay? And you're still leaving the full length of the part that's on the string with leaves, and then you're taking off only the leaves that were about to be buried, you know. And so it just allows more leaf mass. They'll still photosynthesize even on the ground, and it just increases production, I think, some, you know, and keeps the flavor up. But I could see the value, especially given the pressure from the insects, of getting more roots buried, more stem buried, which means more roots, you know. And then next time I'd say we leave the leaves on till we're lowering them once again. Then we take those leaves off, bury them, but then the leaves that we just lowered are taking their place. So we still have maximum photosynthesis for the space.
When you shift over the cucumber, are you planting it at the new shifted position, or do you plant the base right where you originally planted the plant?
Let me show you. So this is where I stopped, I think. Anyway, you see the tops of all those cucumbers? See the tops of all these cucumbers? Oh man, those need to get lowered. This cucumber here was probably originally right around here. So here's this main stem. We took off pretty much most of the branches. This guy wants to grow. This is essentially a sucker, right? So I took those off too on the cucumbers. I trimmed all this off, and here's the main stalk. So here it is growing up in my right hand, but this is where it started. What I'm gonna do is come in here and I'm just gonna bury this soil, okay? And then all of this space that I bury, whatever this is, 2.5-3 feet, all that is gonna re-root and give more energy and production for the plant. I kind of don't remember because I haven't done it until last summer. I think about every 3 times I do that, I add some compost into it. So I'm not, at the end of the season, you can end up really building up your bed. So I'm not losing the fertility that's already in here. I will add some compost into my wheelbarrow, and I'm just coming here, and I'm not burying it huge or deep, really just enough to weight it down.
Weigh it down and allow it to be covered, so when the soil gets wet, it'll start to make adventitious roots and we'll re-root.
So I'm gonna bury this whole thing. And what I don't wanna do are bury any live leaves. So I might even come in here and cut this guy off. I don't wanna bury this guy alive. Cause it'll just kill the leaf, and I'd rather just get rid of it up here.
Well, if you bury a leaf, you can actually start an infection that could damage the root too. You don't want to bury the leaves. They need to be off. The plant can handle a wound. It'll just root from that wound, but it can't handle that leaf being buried very well.
Let me show you all a couple just real quick. So this is a funny little thing, and I'm still learning, and I'm still figuring it out, but it's kind of this dance between how many leaves do I take. I want to leave as much as possible for maximum photosynthesis, but I don't want to come back here tomorrow and have to do this all over again, so I want to take a lot so I can be a little bit more aggressive. And how gentle do I have to be with the cucumbers? And oh gee whiz, what time is it? I'm in a hurry all of a sudden. All those things you will figure out on your own farm if you choose to go this route. The only thing to really understand are the big concepts, which are, again, one single stalk, and having good contact with that soil that you're, with the plant that you're leaving on the ground. So here's one, it's all the way over here. I got a nice cucumber on it, which I'm going to go ahead and take anyway and throw it at Mark. I'll show you this reel in a second. All I'm gonna do is squeeze this and it's gonna fall. I'm gonna scoot it over. It's attached somewhere right here. Pick that off. And down I go. I'm gonna bring it over to about here. Give it a little bit more space. Put my clip on it. Move to the next one. Sometimes I'll wrap them around just for good measure. But you can either do that or use a clip.
And one word there, these spools work probably 85% of the time. Once in a while, it gets bent to where it doesn't quite catch. There's a little catch that's gonna happen. And if you're not holding on to that string further down, the whole thing can drop to the ground. So it's a good idea just to hold on to that string. And if that thing doesn't catch, you can just kind of spot it and you can eyeball where it is and just bend it out a little bit and it'll catch again. But if you don't do that, it can get away.
I'm gonna do one just so you can see. Now, We'll leave the next one. What Pat is saying is leave all the leaves on it until you bury it so you get the most photosynthesis, and he's right. I'm going to bury these tomorrow. So I got two options, and I'll show you option one, which is the one I prefer. As I come in here real quick, and I'm not trying to be fast, it's just you develop it, and you develop an eye for it. And I look up there and I figure, gee whiz, how tall is it? And then I try and guess and take that much off the bottom. Right? I'm gonna just go with that for now. So now you see all those leaves I've taken off, and I've got a nice clean vine. So I'm gonna try and shoot for getting that much of it on the ground. So again, I come up here, I find my plant,
which is totally misbehaving, and wandering off to where it wants to go, which has nothing to do with what we want.
Yeah, and again, I really couldn't encourage y'all enough. And I mean, take whatever you will from it, but just know that if you let them get to this point, what would take you an hour will take you 4 hours. Because now you got to go in here and digging and searching and finding. You see these? This all needs to happen again when this plant is up here, which won't be long. It may actually be Friday or Saturday.
There's a good chance it'll be Friday or Saturday. Yeah.
But if I wait until next Wednesday or Thursday, this plant will be growing in here. If I wait till the week after, it'll be up here. And don't think I've... And those things happen, like it happens. But when you're up here, and boy, let me tell you, it's a lot hotter up here than it is down there, and you're pulling these cucumbers and tomatoes out and trying to find the end and blah, blah, blah. Do this thing twice a week. It makes your life a lot easier. So.
And if you do it twice a week, you don't have to separate them. Usually they have to jump. It's just like you just go over and lower those guys there real fast. Add the next clip or two and you're done.
I tend to be a little, not necessarily rough, but I'm not really gentle with them. Because I know they can take it. And so I'm here and I'm finding myself, this is another plant, maybe? Oh no, there we go.
Yeah, we'll oftentimes work as a team. I could be separating it from below.
It does help to have a ground person. So I know where I want to be, and I drop myself to it, and I come on over, and I'm going to go ahead and put my clip. And again, just can't stress this enough. By keeping those suckers off of them, by keeping them scooting, moving, by giving the stalk access to the ground, to the availability to create more roots, and by giving them enough spacing, I mean, man, they don't stop. They keep going and going and going. I mean, again, as Pat said, when things start to cool off and your days start to get shorter, obviously they'll slow down. I mean, there's nothing we can ever do to avoid that. But you know, I've had it in traditional settings where, you know, you have a regular fence or a trellis or whatnot, and they just get up and up and up, and it's so thick and there's so little airflow, and disease becomes an issue and molds become an issue, and then they get to the top and they grow and they can't find anything and they fall over, and you're putting your arm in there and you're lifting the plant up, and that's okay too, but this is, it requires more attention, but it's a really tight system.
Do me a favor, Rocco, slide that one over and show it lowered without being pruned off. Show what it would look like if you weren't burying it right away.
So if I'm not burying it right away, I'm gonna leave the leaves, and I'm just gonna take this guy and come along here, and same kind of thing, and bring it to there, put my clip.
And those leaves are laying on the ground, but they're still photosynthesizing. Next time he's gotta lower it, then he will take those leaves off right before he lowers it, but he'll leave the leaves on from having lowered it at that time. And then he'll bury that part then, you know.
If you don't take the leaves and you just let it run up the trellis, would the bottom of the plant stop producing?
It does eventually. It's already made its food, yeah.
Right. So it's kind of, you feel better about going and burying it if it's not producing.
Yeah, but
like I say, if we, you know, because he's opting to get as much root mass as he can right now, he's sacrificing photosynthesis. You know, if he leaves these leaves, those leaves there are going to be photosynthesizing, whereas these plants don't have those leaves now, you know? So, okay.
Are you concerned about where you bury the stalk, like interfering with the other root base?
Nah, roots like each other. It's not a problem at all.
Not really.
Yeah. Let's look at the peppers and then call it quits, because I'm sure we're over time by now anyways.
Okay. That's a multi-species summer cover crop. In this case, the biggest ones are warm season grasses and warm season nitrogen fixing legumes are your main ones. These are the mountain fresh. This is a traditional, what they call a stake and string, the Florida weave method that you'll see all over Mills River. There again, difference in this and that. These plants are
determinate,
and they're developed to get this tall, stay about as tall as these stakes, and give as much fruit as possible, as hard as they can, and then they kind of peter out. These are determinate tomatoes, meaning.
In this greenhouse, sometimes they'll get even taller than the stakes. Sure. And they'll go longer than you can imagine, just because they're in the ideal conditions, you know. But they will end before the season's over, just because they are determined. They put a certain amount of growth on, a certain number of fruits, and they're done. Just in here, in these conditions, with this fertility, and the protection of the greenhouse, that's maximized. And that's why he's getting those incredible yields.
Yeah, and these are good, healthy-looking plants. They're
he's
nice.
Real happy with them.
Deep
yeah.
Green, they got good fruit set. They're good-looking plants. These are our peppers that we are putting on this trellising system. Anyway, playing with these will be kind of fun. We're gonna have to a little bit learn as we go, because these peppers and cucumbers, peppers act differently as far as the structure of the plant itself from the cucumbers and tomatoes.
But I'm thinking we might actually go with two roller hooks per plant.
Right, so we may go with two hooks, and then just keep one or two branches going on two hooks.
And then we'll pinch out the growing tips on any other branches, and we'll just keep doing that, you know. It's brand new to us. We've never pruned peppers like that, you know. This is going to be the first year we really do it. Last year, it was kind of, they were that tall, but it was a jungle in here. But it was a mess, you know. We just hadn't figured it out. This year, we know we got to get on them and prune them like crazy. And they should be very impressively productive. You know, we'll keep you posted, but we just see a lot of production from these. They're just getting started now. They went in later than we wanted it. Something we hadn't mentioned is this year we had a failure of the potting soil we bought. The company that we've been buying it from lost kind of control of the conductivity or soluble salts, which are basically nutrients, but if there's too many of them, they inhibit germination. And all of our crops were slowed down by that. Our early germination was thrown off. We kept trying to fix it and didn't get it right till probably sometime in early April. By then, you know, we'd lost our first round of starts and we had to start over again. So ideally, these would have gone in this greenhouse by the middle of April. They went in more, what, like early May?
It was more like that.
Yeah, we're about 3 weeks behind on them. And so they should be like more like this by now, you know. And next year, we'll probably, that's time is one of the things that you're aiming in cultural practices. You want to hit that timing right. And so if you have a greenhouse, you want to take advantage of it and get in there as early as you can and stay in as long as you can and take the maximum advantage of it, you know. I actually think that it might be worth considering doing a little tiny bit of heating to get in earlier and to stay in a little longer. And that much heat might be well worth it, and the fossil fuels saved by not hauling those vegetables from California is probably worth that energy, even when you consider global warming and the use of fossil fuels. Because we have this fancy curtain, and actually let's turn it on and show them it, you know, just go ahead and show them it, you know, just hit close and show them what it does. It's pretty fancy. That happens automatically for us every night, and then it opens up in the morning automatically. That's pretty high tech, pretty fancy. But it means that we can, you know, name a window of when we wanted to do it, and then it'll actually adjust as the light reduces too. We don't even have to come in back in and adjust it, you know. Fancy computer system, which has gone south on us a few times, you know. It's
not. Yeah, I mean, the thing, you know, knowing your greenhouse space and understanding it and that season extension, you know, between some extra pieces of plastic and some hoops and some row cover, you can really go a long way extending your season in your season extension.
And indeed, Tom Elmore uses a product called concrete curing cover, I think, and it basically is row cover with a foam backing. He pulls that over his whole big greenhouse, which he heats with propane to get tomatoes going early, and saves like tons of money every night that he does that. That hour or half hour it takes him to do that is some of his best paid time. Because he doesn't have this fancy infrastructure, which costs a fair amount of money to put in, but he just does it by hand and still accomplishes the same thing, you know. And I don't know that we're going to have light to film it, but we could show you what we do to get a similar kind of production outdoors very cost effectively. We could show the new greenhouse if we want to run up the road for a minute. You want to take the time to do that? Do y'all?
Let's describe it.
Okay, basically we got recycled well pump, scheduled 40 PVC, placed over rebar, and this year we got 3/4 inch conduit to make that rebar extend the height a little bit more. So now it's like a high tunnel. It's like, what, about 10 feet high?
9, 10 feet.
Yeah. And so we're going to be able to use the roller hooks in there. We're going to have to make a really strong support. The greenhouse won't support it. You know, even here we had to put, if you want to look at it, we had to put extra bracing in there to support these. We couldn't really use the greenhouse even for this. The cross pieces really wasn't going to be enough. We had to actually come in and add extra metal. And so we're going to have to sink some heavy duty stuff in the ground for this. But then for the cost of probably $300, we're going to have a 100-foot greenhouse with about 45 plants that are going to be on those kind of trellises growing as fancy heirlooms, you know. Now, if you wanted to get the production, you could be running these things instead. You don't have to see it. That is the description, you know. But this is much, 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 much more money than that system, but you can get similar results. And as you're getting into winter, you go out and get that concrete curing fabric or whatever it is, throw it over the top and move it, you can push those guys into November and still get production with
Absolutely.
No heat.
And that's an important point. It's definitely another class, but it's an important point to understand is that season extension and that greenhouse effect can be achieved without having to, without having the cost of a greenhouse like this. This is a great greenhouse. It's really tight, it's really nice, it's very modern. And that's why, again, we have our high production plants and our production methods here. Again, we want that air. We want some heirlooms. So for really a very inexpensive cost and some PVC bent over some rebar and a piece of plastic on it, basically, we're able to have heirlooms and extend them into the growing season as well.
And about maybe about 6-7 hours of work putting it up, I'd say.
Yeah.
Really not a lot of investment and a whole lot of productive space, you know. Not something you're going to have go through the winter. That PVC will come down real easy in the winter. So it's simply a, you know, basically March through November kind of thing. But in this climate, now in Florida, that'd be a different story.
Yeah, and next year we'll put it somewhere else.
Keep moving it around, yeah. That's about it. Any questions?